So Eileen's finally reached the end of her tether. Carl and Sunita might have very big issues to deal with tonight, and poor old Tina's life hangs in the balance. We told you it was going to be a big week. Coronation Street continues at 9. Right now, though, it's Thursday morning with Holly and Phil.
Feel closer to nature. Nivea Pure and Natural sponsors this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to your Thursday this morning.
Right, fancy a bit of showbiz fabulousness to bring some sparkle to your day? Well, look no further than this lot.
Oh. I like it.
Hand over the money!
Spread the word, would you?
Also, growing up, Prince William has lived life in the public eye, but what really goes on behind palace doors, we've a unique and it's quite controversial insight into the world, the man who one day is set to become king.
And Samantha is in the hub to take us through today's talking points. Hello, Samantha.
Good morning. Now, a new crackdown on classroom discipline will see pupils banned from having their mobile phones in school. Ofsted hopes the ban will help avoid distractions in class and also prevent cyberbullying. Do you think this will work, or is it perhaps too little too late? And new research has found Brits spend £900 million a year on gadgets we rarely use. Fondue sets, ice cream makers and melon ballers are the most forgotten items, but we want to know what gadgets have you got gathering dust. Let us know. Get in touch. As always, you can email us at thismorning@itv.com. You can tweet us or have your say on our Facebook page. We need your comments by midday today, please, so get in touch.
I reckon quite a hefty wedge of that is probably you're responsible for, because you do love a gadget.
Yes, there's not many I don't use, though.
Really? Really?
Yeah, well, there's a couple. We've got a fondue set that's in the cupboard and has never been out once.
See, I have a fondue set and cook fondue all the time.
Really?
Yes, love fondue.
And we've got one of those grilling things.
Yes.
The lean, mean one.
Yep.
Never used that. No. Mm-hmm. No, so I think possibly some of them, but nothing phone-like.
They all get used. Yeah. In fact, the iTablet, what can you call it? I've sort of said it now, haven't I?
Don't do brand names for iPads.
Oh.
What?
Apparently that is the most used one.
Is it?
Yes, that one's been a success. Everybody uses that one, so there you go. Yeah. Anyway, a recent survey reveals that nearly half of women questioned would consider becoming a mum just to take time out of work.
Pretty shocking admission, but what do you think? Is motherhood just an excuse for women to put their feet up? I'm not saying this, by the way, so don't have a go at me.
If you were, you'd have to hold me back, fellas. That's all I'm saying.
Well, I appreciate that completely. This is not a view I hold.
No.
Just put your feet up for a few months. Or is being a mother one of the hardest jobs you'll ever take on?
Well, let us know your thoughts. I'm sure you've got lots to say about this. You need to email thismorning@itv.com and we'll need those comments by 11 o'clock.
Plus, Sue Hill's here with some more crime files. So to make sure you don't miss a thing, here is your lineup today. Lots of big stories to talk about today. We're joined by journalists Carol Malone and John Gaunt. Welcome both. Let's start with the very sad news of the death of hairdresser Vidal Sassoon. Cut and styled the hair of royalty, film stars and models, died at the age of 84. He came in here, I'm not quite sure when he actually came in here, but what a lovely man. Absolutely fascinating.
Yes. It's interesting that all the celebrity hairdressers who've been quoted today in the papers, I think Nicky Clarke said,
There's no one could say a bad word about this bloke. He was so lovely. But, you know, he was totally representative, wasn't he, of the swinging 60s? There was Carnaby Street, there was Vidal, there was Mary Quant.
He created that whole look,
that
didn't he? That
Bob.
I mean, he's one of those cultural icons, isn't he? And there aren't many of those left in Britain today. And again, he's a representative of, you know, a Jewish immigrant family, pulled himself up by his bootstraps and, you know, worked really hard and created this fantastic brand and a fantastic brand name.
He knew he couldn't open a salon in Bond Street because he had an East End accent. So he used to go to the theatre every day to learn how posh people spoke.
Did he?
Yeah, he did. And then started his salons and chains all over the world.
So when are you going?
Incredible. I'm going. Too late. Hair's terrible, voice is terrible.
So the sad death of Vidal Sassoon at 84, lovely guy.
Okay, another news story today. An estimated 400,000 public sector workers are expected to join a 24-hour strike in a dispute over proposed changes to pensions, airports, job centres, tax offices, colleges, driving test centres, museum and military sites will all face disruptions.
This one makes me very cross. I've just come into work today and the streets are all blocked. Everyone's been inconvenienced. They've got banners up saying, you know, hands off our pensions. And I'm thinking, you know, half of the country hasn't got a pension. And the ones that have got a pension that they've saved up for, that they've done themselves, isn't going to bring them anywhere near the cash that the public sector pensions are going to bring these guys. I just think they've got to be a little bit more patient. We're in the mire at the moment.
Yeah, sure.
And this debt has to be paid.
I think the problem is, though, people who worked in the public sector, they got basically a job for life and they got a good pension. That's part of the deal for less money. The facts are...
They've caught up with them now. They have.
And that's the case. I've got a lot of sympathy, though, for the police today, who are also marching on their day off. 30,000 coppers expected to march. Now, theirs isn't really just about pensions and pay. It's about these cuts to services. And they're saying, you know, 16,000 coppers could go, and it was 16,000 police officers they needed to bring in to bring peace back for the riots, Holly, as you say. So I've got a lot of sympathy for the coppers.
Because ultimately, having a decent police force,
we all want that.
Affects us all.
Yeah.
But these guys out there, we're all in trouble at the moment.
What about this? Pension experts say that babies born in 2012 might not get their state pension until they reach 80.
I can see that. I can see us all work until we drop. And I agree with you on the private pension. Everyone's lost the value of the private pension.
But, you know, does anybody really care? You're not going to retire at 65. If I had to retire at 65, I wouldn't know what to do with my life. I just think working is not a bad thing.
It's the option, isn't it?
It is the option, but, you know, young people at 65 are young now.
They're much younger than they used to be. But we're pretty lucky, Carol, because we love gobbing off, and what would we do if we retired?
I prefer to call it commentary.
Now you have been to the theatre.
However.
Gobbing off.
Come on.
Pupils face a ban. Here we go. Is the headline. Ban on mobiles from schools. This is part of a new Ofsted crackdown on classroom discipline. The school apparently is going to be penalised for failing to tackle persistent low-level disruption in lessons under a tough new inspection regime being introduced next term.
Too little, too late. Should have all happened before. I mean, kids need mobile phones, of course. They can be kept in lockers, but it's all about classroom discipline. Wasn't it better? I may sound old-fashioned now, when you stood up when the teacher walked in the room. Wasn't it better when we had proper school uniforms? Wasn't it better when we called them sir or ma'am, not Tony, or whatever their name is?
But when you say kids need mobile phones, they can keep them in their lockers. We never had them.
Times have changed, Holly.
There's lots of things we didn't have. You know, way back when, you didn't have an anaesthetic at the dentist. You know,
but what I'm saying is, it's different, though. We could still make a phone call if we needed to. Yeah, there was a pay phone there, or if it was an emergency, you could go to the teacher, go up to the office.
Why take a step back?
I'm not saying...
You're taking a step back in technology. If you've got your phone and you've finished at the end of the day, and your parents aren't there, you want to make sure that what time you've been picked up, you know, that I think that's a good thing.
There was a story in the paper today about one female teacher was saying that, you know, you can't even say to kids, give me your phone, because she had said it to one young lad, and he was 10 years old, and he put it down his underpants. He said, well, if you want it, you get it. So, you know, you can't. But the bottom line is, having a mobile phone in school, it affects your concentration. You know, we walk around, you know, where we live. People walk in front of cars when they're on the mobile. You can't talk to people because their concentration's gone. Imagine what it's like in a classroom full of kids who are tweeting, texting.
It must be an absolute nightmare.
If you're a teacher...
You just need to bring back proper discipline within the classroom, Carol. It's as simple as that.
Well,
proper discipline. You say about looking down somebody's underpants, a teacher's not even allowed to look into the bag of a child to see if they've got anything, whether it's a phone, drugs or anything. They're not allowed to do it.
The bottom line is, I read a quote today where it was one of the Ofsted guys, you know, the bottom line is, kids deserve a decent education, and they're not going to get one. on if their attention is elsewhere and they're thinking about other things and faffing around with their phone.
So Michael Wilshaw, the chief inspector of schools, said that apart from the distracting effect of a mobile going off in a lesson, handsets can be used for cyberbullying and also accessing online pornography at school.
Yes. I mean, that
get on with your maths.
That shocks me. It's not just about lack of concentration. Yeah. It's like going onto porn sites. I mean, it's...
Well, a little girl called Martha Payne, a nine-year-old girl, will wake up this morning. She's had 40,000 hits on a website. So what she's been doing is taking pictures of her school dinner and posting them up online. This is the pictures that
she... It's meagre, isn't it? Mm. That's a meagre lunch.
Do you know what? It wasn't even that the lunch was meagre, and it's awful. There's nothing healthy in either of us. But it's those plates. They look barbaric.
Like
they look like the sort of things you get in a prison, exactly. Mm. That's not a civilised way to eat, is it?
Well, this is the same problem again, isn't it? We have choice now. I mean, I remember at school, probably the same as you, Philip, we had choice. You either ate it or you didn't eat it. And I used to have free school meals when I was a kid. I'm not ashamed to say it. It was a lifesaver. No, free, not three.
Oh, I thought you said three.
I'm going to go to that theatre allocution course for you, love. But anyway, free school meals. And the bottom line is, you don't need to have that choice. The kids should be getting a balanced meal, says Mr. Fitness.
Yes, I was just, yeah.
She posted these. She says that they've calculated it's 100% effective at preventing... Oh, hang on a second, that's the wrong one. She's saying that Martha Payne had a miserable school dinners set to spark an outcry over nutrition for the nation's children, turned her into an overnight star on the internet when she posted those.
It makes you think that Jamie Oliver wasted his time, doesn't it?
Yeah,
really?
But actually that's a good use of mobile phones, isn't it?
Yeah,
well, she's probably taken
she did ask permission, though. Yeah. It's part of the project,
but it's a
so
good
she
use.
Did ask for permission.
I bet they regret that.
I bet they do.
The girls as young as 11 and 12 should be fitted with coils after unprotected sex rather than being given the morning after pill, say researchers. This is Professor James Trussell from Princeton University in the US. Said doctors and nurses should hand out coils to girls as young as 11 and 12. Apparently, it's almost 100% effective, whereas the emergency pill has failure rates up to 3%.
This makes me feel sick to my... Yeah. It actually makes me feel physically sick, the thought of an 11-year-old child having a coil inserted inside her. And anyway, why are we accepting the fact that 11-year-old kids might have sex? Yeah. You know, I don't think I kissed a boy when I was 15, but that's not the point. The point is 11-year-olds shouldn't be having sex. And what we should be fighting for as a society is to stop them having sex, not saying, oh, well, they're going to do it anyway,
and
facilitating it.
Also, Carol, it's a minority who are doing it, but we usually we legislate for a minority rather than the majority. The majority of teenage kids and young kids are not having sexual intercourse. And, of course, the coil, just like the pill, doesn't help them when it comes to things like chlamydia and other diseases. We need barrier contraception for that. But basically, we should be teaching our kids to respect themselves and respect their bodies more and push them forward in that way, in my opinion.
The coil wasn't suitable for women until after they'd had their first child. I might be wrong on that.
No, because when I was kind of in my 20s, girls could have a coil. Mm. But I never wanted to have a coil because...
No, but you didn't know... We don't know what the effects are going to be on young girls as young as 11. If they're using one at that stage, later on in life...
I've known just the physical effects of when it goes wrong, it can cause damage internally. Yeah. Now, that is... That, on an 11-year-old little girl, I don't think so.
About that. Well, finally finish on this one. Laptop-wielding cafe conquerors who take up seats at coffee shop tables for hours while nursing a single cappuccino are increasingly to blame for arguments between customers, according to a study. We've actually got a clip here from Corrie, which sort of sums this up.
Oh, yeah. How long has she been sitting there?
About 10 minutes.
More like half an hour. For a cup of tea and an Eccles cake, I don't think so. Good afternoon.
Oh, hello.
Can I get you a top-up?
I finished, thank you.
Off you go, then.
I'm sorry.
There are paying customers who need your seat. If you'd be so kind.
Yes, of course.
Well, individual workers are effectively setting up their entire office at a table, laying out the laptop, the smartphone, the iPad, the bag, ordering a large skinny latte and then staying there for the whole afternoon.
All we have to say is J.K. Rowling, who's now worth £356 million and can just go, you know...
And she wrote the book
in cafes.
And I must admit, I'm guilty as charged, because there's nothing better, is there, than sitting there. Myself and my brother, we sit there with our laptops and our... iMacs and iMacs, our pads, and just talk to each other. And we are there for ages and ages. But the answer is really to have more broadband. If we were a more progressive country like Sweden or Scandinavia, where they've got much more broadband everywhere and the broadband is free,
then, you could then sit life would be on the better. Street.
We could sit on the street and sell the big issue at the same time.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very Thank much you. Indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank
right,
you.
Still to come, Sue Hill has more crimes she needs your help with. That's after the break.
Feel closer to nature. Nivea Pure and Natural sponsors this morning.
Welcome back in just a moment. Sue Hill is here with some more crimes she needs your help with.
But first, Lisa Faulkner has details how you could be a massive £25,000 better off.
Fancy letting us spoil you this summer? Get set for a whopping £20,000 in tax-free cash and much, much more.
There's £5,000 to spend at Marks & Spencer, so whatever your summer essentials are, treat yourself. For your chance to have great fun with this prize worth £25,000, just answer this question correctly. Latte and espresso are both types of what? A. Mushroom, B. Coffee, C. Bread. Call 09012 93 33 33. Calls cost no more than £1.03 from BT Landlines. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Text your answer A, B or C to 83336. Text costs £1 plus one standard network rate message. You can also enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at 5 p.m. on Sunday the 13th of May will not be counted, but may still be charged. Good luck.
Yes, good luck with that. Now, a shocking assault on a 94-year-old pensioner has dominated the news headlines this week.
Well, that's the first case in this week's crime file with former Met Detective Chief Superintendent Sue Hill. And we've been talking about this a couple of times on the show this week because it is such a shocking crime.
Absolutely shocking. I've got to say, in my experience, I've never known anything like that. And how, you know, there is a reward. And it's funny when I heard Nick Ferrari saying, why do you need a reward? Somebody that comes in a little old lady's home and here we have a picture of a little Emma there, 94 years old, wheelchair bound, in her bed between 9 o'clock in the evening. We know she was in bed on the 30th of April, which was a Monday night, and the following morning at 9 o'clock she was found by the carers. Now somebody, they believe, the police think it could be, you know, mistaken identity, they've gone to the wrong property, which can be the case, because why else can you believe that anyone would beat this little lady to a pulp like this?
I think what Nick Ferrari's point was, why do you need
why would you?
It shouldn't need a reward. If you know who someone is, then you shouldn't need paying for that information.
Yeah, and, also,
and he said that if it works, then fine.
Why not?
Mrs. Winnell underwent emergency surgery after suffering a fractured skull, broken arm and wrist, and partially severed finger, which her family believed was hacked off as a warning.
Yeah, I mean, I think the police are hoping the DNA will come through on clothing, but if you are watching, if you've got any idea to do that to a 94-year-old lady who's at home, can you imagine crying in the middle of the night and someone beating you, you're helpless.
No, so awful. What I don't understand about the mistaken identity thing is, all right, OK, so you burst into the wrong house, you burst into the wrong bedroom, you attack someone in bed, it wouldn't have been very long, even in the dark, before you realise that this is a frail old lady, unless the person you were looking for was another frail old lady.
No, unless it's someone who may be drug-induced. People do have, you know, funny psychotic episodes, or someone who's high on drugs, who's lost the plot, adrenaline's flow, and they've gone in and reacted. I mean, I dealt with a murder many years ago of a little lady who was stabbed about 10 times. A young girl walked in and stabbed her, and just she was high on drugs. So, you know, that may be the case, we don't know. Or could it be just someone, a frenzied attack? That's why we need to find out who it is.
OK, well, if you have any information, then contact West Midlands Police on 101 or Crime Stoppers on 0800 555 111.
Well, there's a burglary at a children's play centre now that we're asking for help.
That's right, and this is at Spring Lane in Hackney. Why it's so very sad, and this is an emotional plea to those people who keep ransacking. It's a place, a day centre for 200 little children. Here we have them here. They've got learning difficulties. They're disabled children, and the place keeps getting ransacked by burglars, and 8 times since last August. They've even taken and damaged the CCTV camera, so the centre can't keep affording to replace it. So these little children, you know, are being disrupted, their daily lives, it's respite for their parents, and it is an emotional plea. if you've got any idea, local people in Hackney, who is doing this, if you can't hand them over, maybe you could tell them, just stop doing it, please. Because these kids, they're talking about them being baddies. You know, every time the police go there, they're saying, oh, we know the baddies have been here. Please, you know, emotional appeal, just stop doing it. If you know who's doing it, hand them over or just say, leave it out. Go and pick on
someone. Well, they've stolen the centre's lawnmowers and petty cash and specialist equipment for the kids.
Yeah, their belongings. It's just awful, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's
really horrible. If you've got any information, then you can call the Met Police on 101 or Crime Stoppers on the number. It's the same one all the time, the Crime Stoppers number. It's 0800 555 111.
So the next case we're looking at is you need information on a sexual assault. This is a 17-year-old girl.
Yeah, it's a nasty sexual assault on a 17-year-old girl who was out for an evening in the Voodoo Bar in Wellington Street in Barnsley on the 19th of November at 11:30 at night. Now, we've got an image of someone that the police need to speak to in relation to this incident. We can't go into the details of the sexual assault, but it is serious. And here we have, again, I keep saying it, if only our CCTV was better, but it's quite a clear image and the description is very good. This guy had a blonde Mohican hairstyle, so he is distinctive, he does stand out. And also, he's got a small patch-style beard from his lower lip down to his chin. And here you have him here on a side view. Now, as I say, I'll take you back, November the 19th last year, and he sexually assaulted a little girl, he's 17 years old, who was out that night for a drink. So, if you know who he is, and we believe he's got a Polish accent, or Eastern European, or that's a nationality they believe he is. So, if you know who he is, or he might want to give himself up too, because the police will find you.
So that's information on that one. You call South Yorkshire Police on 101, quoting incident 740. All these details on the website or the Crime Stoppers number.
Right, moving on to a glass attack in Swindon. Tell us about this.
Just before you do that, I'm going to just say that we've got a photograph of this glass attack, and it's particularly gruesome. So if you want to turn away or give yourself a couple of seconds to move anyone who's got... maybe little feet around you who wants to get out of the way, then we'll show that. I'm going to show that picture in a second.
Yeah, this is quite ironic because I've actually been to this bar in Swindon. It's where my family live, and my niece had her engagement party here. And it's quite a nice bar. It's called The Spot in Old Town. This happened on the 29th of April, about 12:30 at night. And the bars, there's three separate bars. And the victim, as you say, Phil, he's done nothing wrong. He's queuing up at the bar and he gets glassed into his back of his neck. And it is a horrific, horrific
injury.
Here
comes the picture. There you go. So that really is a deep, deep wound, isn't
Multiple laceration there and a deep, deep, you know, he's been glassed in the back of his neck. Now, the police in Wiltshire...
OK, it's gone now, we won't show it again.
Yeah. They've got a group of people they believe could be from the Outham area, and one particular image, they believe that this group were in the bar that night, well, they know the group were in the bar, and here on the right-hand side, the guy we're particularly interested in, wearing that red jumper...
That's so clear, that
Very,
picture.
Very clear. Absolutely very, very clear. Now, what we're saying, we're not saying that you were the man that did it, but we need to, the police need to speak to him about this. I say the description, he's around 20, slim build, brown hair, wearing a bright red V-neck jumper and sand-coloured trousers. Here he is again there.
There's no way that bunch of lads won't be recognised.
Absolutely.
From that
Somebody must know who they are. You've just seen that victim being glassed, and here we have them, the group, earlier in the evening. So that young man there, we particularly need to speak to, all the police in Wiltshire particularly need to speak to you.
So you call the Wiltshire Police on 101 or the Crime Stoppers number.
Right, time to take a look at a scam which could affect up to 20 million of us.
Well, since 2010, paying for goods in shops has been made quicker and easier thanks to contactless bank cards.
The checkout in thousands of shops across the nation. Small electric readers mean that if you're making a transaction for £10 or less, then you don't have to insert your card into the machine and type your PIN. All you need to do is swipe your card over them. But how safe are they to use? Well, technology consultant Thomas Cannon joins us now. Welcome to you. Sounds pretty frightening, really.
It does. We don't want to scaremonger people, but it is possible to read details from a credit card wirelessly. Just by waving your phone over a credit card, for instance.
Not an ordinary credit card, a contactless
credit card.
So this is one of the ones that if you were going to pay, then you would just swipe it or hold it over something, and normally you would use this for what? Where would it be used?
For low value transactions, at fast food restaurants, sandwiches, that kind of thing.
So it's a bit like a sort of bus pass type thing
just
system,
like the,
but with your credit card. Yeah. So therefore, how do you protect yourself? What would you do?
It's quite difficult. There are a number of things you can do, though. There are special wallets you can buy that are shielded.
I bet you've got one here.
You can procure those from a number of places online.
So this is shielded because it has, what is it? It's got metal inside, yeah.
It has like a piece of tin foil inside.
Yeah.
And you can do the same yourself. You could put a piece of tin foil in your wallet. It's a bit extreme, but there are not many ways to safeguard against this. Of course, if any fraudulent transactions are carried out, the banks will refund your money, assuming you spot the fraudulent transaction. Yeah. So that's another top tip, is just good practice to check your account every month.
So the piece of kit you've got down there...
Yeah, actually, I have a demonstration here, just using a phone. A real criminal would probably use a much more powerful piece of equipment. But you can do it with an ordinary phone that has a wireless reader in it. So you can use your phone to pay for items, but with a specially created app, and if you have the skills, you can also use it to read a card. So I have a dummy card here. It's my credit card, but it's not active. And just by placing the phone over the card, it will read the details.
Oh, my God, that fast?
That fast. That's my name, it's the full card number, and it's the expiry.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. And that so doesn't, they don't have the security digit, the three numbers on the back.
Exactly.
So in a lot of ways, they can't use it that way. But there are companies that actually don't require that.
That's
so,
right,
so
indeed. Yes, the fraud potential is limited, but it does exist. There are places you can use those details to pay for items.
I can't believe that.
So the thing to, you could just put any piece of kit on. You've got your wallet on a bar, wallet on a table. Yeah. Someone comes in, has a chat with you, puts the phone down on the top, and then off you go, and
absolutely,
then you've got it. Now, I will read this statement here from the UK Cards Association. Contactless cards are very safe. Card fraud's at its lowest level for over a decade. No evidence that fraudsters are targeting contactless cards. Mm-hmm. The information available to a fraudster is limited to the long card number, the expiry date, and on some contactless cards, the customer's name. Most importantly, as you said, it doesn't include a three-digit security code from the back of the card. This, along with the cardholder's address, is required by the vast majority of businesses who accept cards who have robust security checks in place. But there are some places that don't require those.
Absolutely, and it's been demonstrated in America that you can take those details and program them onto a magnetic swipe card that we used to use in this country, and they don't use chip and pin there yet, so you can use the swipe card to pay for items, and that's been demonstrated live.
Good. Okay. Well, thank you very much indeed for doing that. Something to be aware of, that's for sure. Sue, thank you very much indeed. If you want more information on this scam, or you want to get hold of one of the wallets that I showed you, then go to our website, itv.com/thismorning. All the details of the crimes that we've talked about and the police numbers are on the website as well.
Right, still to come, Sam Kelly made it through to Saturday's Britain's Got Talent final. He's here along with Stephen Mulhern after this break. Welcome back. Well, another night, another group of the weird and wonderful and darn right brilliant. Stephen Mulhern's here with the Britain's Got Talent gossip. Hello.
Hello, hello. You all right?
Yeah, very good. Very good.
Well, I want to start with Malachi. You know, we've spoken about him many times before.
I would, you know, if it was me and I was the production team, I'd have been absolutely terrified, because the last thing you want is a repeat of what happened in the auditions.
Yeah, for those that didn't see it, you know, he did cry in his first audition, then got a second chance, then got through to the live shows. And last night was booted out, and this was his reaction. No one,
no one, no one. The act I'm going to send through to the final is New School.
Yeah. Just a quick word.
Give him a couple of seconds. Come on, guys. Come on.
You're all right.
You're
okay.
Right.
Yeah. Now you heard what they said. You did incredibly well tonight. You did brilliantly. And you're going to take this, and you're going to grow and be a great performer. And look at that!
I was upset, as you can see, but the thing is, you know, last time I was here, you mentioned about, you know, if kids don't get put into these sort of competitions, then, look, you can't...
I mean, cotton wool, you've got to learn about disappointment,
yeah.
You know, and I think that he wanted to do it, he wasn't forced into doing it.
No,
absolutely.
Not.
And also, he's got a great voice.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm sure he'll do well.
And he may come back in future years, you know, and nail it.
And he might get his first girlfriend. All those girls are hugging him, feeling sorry for him.
And let's not forget the wild card.
Yes. Well, you never know.
Not over.
Personally, I don't know whether he will get it.
Yeah.
But there is always that chance. New School, the only dance troupe that have made it through to the finals so far. Mm. Twist and Pulse could be their only competition if they get the wild card, but last night they were great.
very, very good and very young.
Really young. You know, the oldest is the only guy that we could talk to on Britain's Got More Talent, who's 17. The youngest is 10, and it goes up to 14 and 15.
God, they are really young, aren't they?
They're really young, but very tight. And it's amazing, really, because Twist and Pulse didn't go through, and they were amazing.
I know.
Go on.
I think Twist and Pulse slightly better.
I love the fact you go.
I'm scared to say that, but I did.
But if they do get the wild card, which I think they deserve it, by the way,
then we'll find out.
Then they could be really
important. What about some strange stuff last night?
Yeah.
Gattis,
you know, it was really awkward, and you'll see why. You know, he's a comedian, but listen to his jokes.
Why do they go there at all? I love your laugh, Amanda. I'm just gonna finish on a quick joke. When it's hot, I am a fan of a fan. Well, I finished on a less funny joke on purpose because I don't want you to think that I'm a complete genius. Thank you and have some fantastic dreams tonight.
But you're laughing. A lot of people say, you know, you either get him or you don't get him. Yeah. I mean, it is peculiar, but it did make them laugh.
Yeah, but, you know, you were laughing there, but are you laughing at him?
No, I wasn't laughing with him. No. I was just thinking if someone wrote him some really good rubbish material, he could be brilliant.
Well, the thing is, you just repeated virtually exactly what David Walliams said.
Nah.
He said, you know, as long as he gets the jokes and the perfect writers,
yes,
he could be a genius. But
honestly, I feel very good. We didn't see it last night because we were recording our interview with Alan Carr, so I have to say I wasn't copying David.
But but you know when you're watching an act and you go, oh no, I really felt for
him.
Did you? Yeah, I did. But Sugar Dandy's complete opposite.
Yeah.
They just make you smile.
Let's have a look.
That is so true.
I don't mean this in a horrible way, but you remember when you used to have those acts that they'd have like a stuck-on suit stuck onto them, like a sort of fake doll dancer? It sort of looks like that. Like there.
Look, the thing is, right, is that lots of people have been, you know, whether it be in the street or on Twitter, have been saying to me, is David going to continue to tease Simon? Well, last night, he did. You know, we had a caller on Britain's Got More Talent, which you can see tonight at 10 o'clock on ITV2. And this is what David said to Simon. Have a listen.
Sugar Dandies were your favourite acts of tonight. How did you feel when Simon buzzed them?
I think Simon actually found it very erotic. He was concerned. He wanted it to stop because otherwise he may have... This desk might have tipped over.
That's wonderful.
Well, a recording artist's voice and a soulful performance with No Smoke and Mirrors, just some of the amazing comments that saw Sam Kelly win his place in Saturday night's final.
Congratulations, I think you're the one to watch tonight.
Everybody in the audience just absolutely loved it. I loved you.
That's the second time you've done something beautiful. If you went through to the final, I'd like you to kick it up a bit.
You sound like a recording artist and you've got charisma. Brilliant.
Good comments.
Very good comments.
Welcome. So how did it feel getting to that stage?
I just never expected it. I think that's the weirdest thing, like, I'm used to just kind of playing in pubs and stuff, and that's what I do. I've been doing it for years. And yeah,
it's a massive stage, isn't it? Britain's Got Talent. And Amanda said there that she'd like to see you next time to do something. You know, you've done beautiful things, something a bit bigger, something a bit different. Are you going to do that, or are you going to stick with what you know?
It's good to have that opinion because it gives me something else to consider when I'm deciding what to do.
Yeah.
And because I've got lots of ideas. And I think I'm going to try and sort of stick to what I'm doing, but bring something else to it. Because
Simon disagreed with Amanda's comments, didn't he? And so thinking about your next performance, do you know already what you're going to do?
No, I don't. I should have. Well, I wasn't expecting to get through. I should have rehearsed. I've got lots of ideas, so I think I'll just take into account what they've said and hopefully some, come up with something.
You know, just before we went into that clip, you whispered to me, this is just so weird. And I think that's really easy to forget that actually you're a jobbing sort of musician that goes around clubs and student unions and all that sort of stuff. Mm. Now you're in front of millions and millions of people with the chance of a lifetime. It's a massive deal. But obviously, look, this is a competition. Tonight is a really interesting thing on Britain's Got Talent because Ryan, who auditioned for The Voice in Ireland, and signed a contract for that, then had to decide whether he left that and came to Britain's Got Talent or whether he stayed with that show. But actually, he's left that show. He's now come to us. Here he is here. And if you look at him, obviously what he does is exactly what Sam does, the guitar, you know, sort of ballad sort of songs. So how worried are you about him?
I love that song, mate. It's such a quality song. And he showed me some of his other songs as well, and they're just brilliant.
You should sing that in the final.
That would annoy him, wouldn't it? Just lift it from tonight.
Put me on before him, and then don't tell him.
He's got nowhere to go. that is ruthless. Amazing. But genius.
Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you very much. No worries.
Right, fancy £20,000 hard cash, £5,000 of shopping vouchers. Here's today's competition.
This week's prize is full of seriously tempting ingredients. For starters, there's £20,000 in cash. And to take care of your family's summer essentials, there's £5,000 to splash at M&S. For your chance to spoil everyone with this prize worth £25,000, just answer this question correctly. Latte and espresso are both types of what? A. Mushroom, B. Coffee, C. Bread. Call 09012 93 33 33. Calls cost no more than £1.03 from BT Landlines. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Text your answer A, B or C to 83336. Text costs £1 plus one standard network rate message. You can also enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at 5 p.m. on Sunday the 13th of May will not be counted, but may still be charged. Good luck.
Yeah, the very best of luck. As a young boy, he lived through constant tabloid revelations about his parents' marriage, who divorced when he was just 10, and then 5 years later, he lost his mum in an horrific car accident.
Yet through it all, Prince William always remained dignified, maturing into a popular member of the royal family who married his long-term girlfriend last year.
So, what's our future king like behind closed doors? Well, one woman who's uncovered a number of stories about the prince is royal author and commentator Penny Juna, and she joins us now. Welcome. I suppose the first question's got to be, how do you know? How close are you, or is this just regurgitating stuff that we've already heard before?
No, it's not at all regurgitating stuff. I mean, I believe that I'm probably the first author who has got as close as I have done. I mean, I have to tell you, I have not sat down and had conversations with William himself. He hates talking about himself, but he did, I'm very pleased to say, allow his household to talk to me.
So this has approval?
No, it doesn't have approval. It doesn't have approval. I've written books, royal books, for 30 years, and none of them has been approved.
Mm. I have had help.
Yes, cooperation, help. Yeah. Which just enables me to get to the true story.
Sure.
You know? I mean, it's...
Well, that you've been criticised. In today's Mail, there's an article by Catherine Osler, and she starts it by saying that you've been accused of being insensitive, untruthful, poisonous, a hatchet merchant who moonlights as Camilla Barker Bowles' public relations guru and is probably in love with Prince Charles.
There's a comment that were posted online. The Daily Mail has been serialising my book, and... You know as well as I do that serialisation is about taking little fillets of books and patching them together and creating really hysterical headlines. They are selling newspapers. And in the course of... I mean, the Daily Mail took from my book 11,000 words over 3 days. Mm. The book is 150,000 words long. You cannot tell the story of anyone's life without talking about their childhood. I talked about his childhood, which inevitably means talking about the marriage problems between Diana and Charles and the Camilla issue. And I go through that. I mean, I've written about it in the past, and I'm simply... That is regurgitated. That's my book, regurgitated. But it's a brief bit in the beginning. The bulk of the book is about William and the sort of man that this childhood created. Mm.
And it's a childhood that you say that Diana actually didn't know how to be a mother.
Diana had never been properly mothered herself. I mean, Diana's problems really sprang from her childhood, as most people's do. When she was 6 years old, her mother left home. Now, 6 years, I mean, she didn't understand that the reason her mother left home, A, was that she was in a very unhappy and abusive relationship with Diana's father, but she had lost custody of her children. Mm-hmm. She fell in love with somebody else. She saw a chance to escape from this terrible marriage, and she fully expected to get custody of her children. She had four children. Diana was the third. Mm-hmm. And in the custody proceedings, her own mother gave evidence against her and called her a bad mother. The result of that was that she lost custody of those children. Now, Diana, just 6 years old, has no idea about any of that. All she knows is that her mother doesn't love her enough to want to be with her.
So you say that had a serious impact on Diana, and then subsequently that had, what sort of an impact did that have on William?
Well, you actually asked the question, was she a good mother or was she an inadequate mother? The real problem with Diana was that because she was not mothered properly, she had no real role model on how to be a mother.
But she looked fantastic. The pictures we saw public as a loving mother.
She was.
The boys obviously adored her.
Don't get me wrong. Please don't get me wrong. She adored those boys, absolutely adored them. But her relationship with them was probably rather more like a big sister. Mm. They had great fun together. But, I mean, Diana was... You know, these headlines today in the Daily Mail and the comments online, they make me sound as though I am constantly down on Diana. Mm. I am not. I never have been. She was a fantastic woman, and she did a huge amount for the royal family. She brought them into the 20th century. She introduced a whole new informal style of being royal. Mm. And she took on causes that, you know, would never have seen the light of day without her.
Well, let's talk about the man, the principal man here. Let's talk about William. What do you learn about him? What can you tell us about him that we didn't know?
I can tell you how private he is. I mean, that's one of the reasons he didn't want to be interviewed. He's intensely private, and he has learnt a huge amount from watching what happened to his parents. Mm. The person he takes his role from, I mean, his role model, is actually the Queen, who is also intensely private. I mean, he saw what happened when his parents talked about their private life. And it's a form of self-protection. Mm. He is intensely protective of his... He will give everything, as his father has done, actually. He will give body and, you know, all the hours God sent, he will give to duty. Mm. I'm absolutely sure
when
of that.
When you know that...
But he won't give his soul, and that's what Prince Charles gave away.
So when you know that, is it quite difficult writing a book when you sort of do that for him?
Then? No, because I'm not doing that. I have not intruded... I think he would agree.
Well,
into his
there
life.
Was one quote in there, sort of saying that at one point he was pushing tissues under the door to Diana, saying, "I don't want to see you crying, Mummy."
Yes.
And it's like, how?
Diana told that story herself.
Did she?
Yes.
Wow. Gosh.
And what sort of a king do you think he'll make?
I think he'll be fantastic. The great thing about him is he has been surrounded by very loving, very supportive people. I mean, that's how come he's not a wreck. Mm. You know, most people, if you grew up on a sink estate with the kind of childhood he'd had, you'd very likely be off the rails. He's not, because he's constant... Mm. Not, he didn't just have his parents to support him and to love him.
And now he's got Kate, of course.
And now he's got Kate.
Yeah.
Penny, thank you very much indeed for coming in. This is the book we're talking about, Prince William, Born to be King, an Intimate Portrait. And thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Fascinating.
Still to come, Denise Van Outen opens up her baby diaries to chat about a life with a toddler.
Plus, Matt LeBlanc is going to be here. How you doing?
How you doing?
See you after the news.
Welcome back. We're live till 12:30. Still to come, in a recent survey, nearly half of women questioned said they might consider becoming a mum simply to take time off work.
We meet the woman who isn't surprised by the findings, saying that motherhood is just an excuse to escape from your job and put your feet up. And a single mum who says it's utter rubbish and looking after kids is harder than any office job.
Plus, Samanthi is still in the hub for us. What have you got, Samanthi?
Well, big reaction from Penny Jura and talking about her new biography of Prince William. And our viewers seem to be very defensive of the royals and the princes. But Lisa Parrott says, I just think Diana would be so proud of William and Harry if she were alive. They've both turned out very thoughtful young men. And Stephen McDonald says, as much as I'm not a fan of Penny Jura, I do want to read the book. Any new stories or insights into Diana and her sons, I want to read them. Now, unsurprisingly, we've also had a big reaction to the story we were talking about earlier, which is that Ofsted are planning to ban mobile phones in schools. Linda Reynolds says, about time too. They should never have been allowed in the first place. Leanne says, I don't see it should be an issue. My daughter's schools have them handed in to the teacher in the morning and they get them back at the end of the day. Simple.
Thanks,
that's very wise.
We're only halfway through the show today and
are
we've
we?
Still got tons more showbiz stuffed up our sleeves.
What's not to like?
You think if you died, the other friends would come to your funeral?
Not quite the big man you used to be, are you?
Hand over the money!
Spread the word, would you?
Driving like a mad person! I am a mad person!
All of that still to come. Women only have a baby to take time off work. It's a controversial statement, but according to a recent poll, nearly half of the women questioned said they might consider motherhood as an option for a career break.
Well, we're joined by Daily Mail columnist Liz Jones, who isn't surprised by the findings, claiming having a baby is an excuse for women to put their feet off. And Radio Foded presenter Petri Hoskin flatly disagrees, saying anyone who believes becoming a mum is an easy option needs their head examining. And, Liz, I'm going to come straight to you, first of all. What do you mean by this?
I was only half joking. Of course women can have maternity leave and have children, and it's a very, very hard job, and I'm sure it's exhausting, if not more so than being in the workplace. But I think often, and I say this as an employer of women, about 30 women when I was the editor of a magazine, they forget what they've left behind. They forget that other people have to pick up the loose ends. They have to sort of fill in all the gaps. So really it's about how you take your maternity leave. I would rather that women phoned in more regularly, came in for meetings, gave me ideas. I mean, often women
would go...
But
the point of maternity leave is it's a very special time, I think. When you've just had a baby, it's very important for bonding. That baby needs, if you're feeding, you can't be popping into meetings when you're on a 3-hour feeding cycle unless you're happy for them to sit there breastfeeding in a meeting. I'm not sure how that would work.
But there's a recession. It's a very, very tough time at the moment. And I think 12 months is a very long time to be out of the workplace. I mean, the business I'm in, which was fashion, I would have my fashion editor disappear for a year. She'd come back for a few months, then she'd disappear for another year. And during that time, she wouldn't have phoned in, kept up with trends. I just think it's about being a little bit more aware of what's happening back at the office.
So women shouldn't get pregnant during a recession?
No, they can get pregnant during the recession, but A, I think men need to step up to the mark more to help women so it isn't all on their shoulders, and I don't think they're doing that, even during a recession. And I also think that it's about remaining involved while you're on maternity leave. I didn't hear a word from my employees on maternity leave, apart from when they came in to get the baby gifts. That's the only time I saw them.
I'm sorry, I've got to come in here, because I don't buy this idea that as soon as you have a baby, you switch off your brain. I, as a journalist, when I had my son, which is a million years ago now, I kept up with the news, I read the newspapers, I saw what people were wearing in the street. I didn't become an idiot, and I didn't lock myself away in some kind of convent. I mean, you're still part of the world.
Well, I'm talking about my experience employing 30 women on a magazine, and you never heard from them. Of course there are exceptions, and I think really there are exceptions among the self-employed. I think it happens less so when your job, you feel it's very secure.
Do you believe a woman has it? You say at the beginning of this, which is interesting, because I often wonder whether you say these things just to get a reaction, because you said you were only half joking. So we're not sure how much of what you wrote you actually seriously mean. Do you think it is a woman's God-given right to have a child?
I think it's a privilege to have a child. I think women
who
have children.
You said there
are
enough children in the world, you know, we don't need any more.
Well, women who have children are very lucky, and it's their choice. It's not my choice to support another woman's lifestyle decision. Women who don't have children and men are the ones who are stuck in the office.
Is having children a lifestyle decision, or is it something that there is a need, a biological need to do?
Yes, but why does that have to impact so heavily on the workplace? And I've seen it changed over the years.
But that's only because more women are working. That's the reason why that's changed over years, and because you can now have it all. You can actually do all those things. But the one thing that I'll just say to you is, like, as a woman, women do really need to stick together. It doesn't help having women like you coming across.
But it makes women less employable because
of this. It shouldn't have to. By putting it
as an
employer, you'll make that happen. It shouldn't do.
As an employer, I would be more likely to employ a woman who's perhaps in her 50s than a woman in her late 20s. Time and time again, as an editor, I would nurture young women. I would give them experience.
You do know that's illegal, I would prejudice is not allowed.
Train them, nurture them, and the minute they got to the point of fruition, they would disappear. And there was no sort of gratitude that you'd nurtured them, and they didn't really feel they were letting you down, which I find a bit strange. But
you said in your article that you wrote, you said that having babies is a lifestyle choice, not a right. Now, I'm just going to take you back to one of your other articles that you wrote in November 2011. You wrote here, this was when you were talking about stealing your boyfriend's condom at the time and trying to get pregnant. I resolved to steal his sperm from him in the middle of the night. I thought it was my right, given that he was living with me and that I had bought him so many blah, 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 blah. You thought it was your right then, and to have a baby as a woman.
But I wouldn't have taken a year's maternity leave and never called in the office.
Do you know?
I'd have probably taken 2 weeks.
Say, you don't know that. This is the point of view, if you don't mind my saying, of a woman who doesn't have a child. It affects people differently.
I think women who don't have children are the ones who are discriminated against.
No, they're not.
We're the ones in the office at 6 o'clock when everyone rushes home. I sat opposite women on the Sunday Times for 11 years. I knew the names of their children, the names of their nannies, what carpet they had.
But you're talking about discriminating against all women, including women like you, who choose not to have children or don't have children.
Yeah, but you choose to have children. It's a choice.
Yeah, but you will be... By saying you won't employ women of a certain age group, you're discriminating against yourself as well.
If this has happened with an employer who has discriminated, just admitted that you've discriminated against women who were,
generally in the workplace you would tend to employ, you would think perhaps twice.
You're fluffing that up a bit now. You actually said that you wouldn't do, you actively didn't do it yourself when you were employing women. Now, if that's one place, then it must happen elsewhere. It must happen a lot.
That women
will be discriminated against if they are of childbearing age.
There's no question. I do a radio phone-in show, and often I'll open up the lines to a story like this. Literally, the question is, would you employ women? The interesting thing is on LBC is that you have to take both sides. So you got people phoning up going, I'm a business person. There is no way, with Liz, absolutely agreeing with Liz, saying there is no way that I would employ a woman of childbearing age. But that discriminates again, like I said, against women who don't want to have children or can't have children. What's the alternative? The best thing that's happened in this debate is what happened yesterday in the Queen's speech about that men, if you equal it, if you make both equally annoying to employ or equally expensive, then you take the heat out of it.
I think that's
I'm with Holly.
Right.
There's too much backlash against women at the moment, and I don't know where it's coming from, but women working.
It's sad when it comes from a woman.
Yeah.
I think women it's this having it all thing. We've been sort of duped and tricked by feminism into believing we can have it all. We can't really. I don't think we can.
I think it's
too tough. You know, I used to really admire women after the Second World War. They would become teachers, matrons. They didn't get married because there weren't as many men around. They were married to their job and they were amazing. I remember the teachers I had at school, you know, we called them spinsters. But they didn't have children, they didn't have husbands. They were fantastic at that job. And that breed of woman has disappeared.
No,
Final 10 seconds.
No, I'm just going to say that I think that women are getting a hard time at the moment. I do appreciate that businesses have a tough time, but we have got to stick together. If we want to stay at home and have a baby, have one. That's what feminism is.
We're going to have to leave it there. Yes. Matt LeBlanc's here after the break. Everyone can agree that that's a very good idea. See you in a moment.
Welcome back. Matt LeBlanc in just a sec. First, it's competition time.
How do you fancy celebrating the summer? A new wardrobe, slap-up meals, or boosting your savings? With a whopping £20,000, the choice is yours.
As well as the cash, there's also £5,000 to spend in-store at Marks & Spencer. For a chance to shop till you drop, or sit back and save, just answer this question correctly. Latte and espresso are both types of what? A. Mushroom, B. Coffee, C. Bread. Call 09012 933333. Calls cost no more than £1.03 from BT Landlines. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Text your answer A, B or C to 83336. Text costs £1 plus one standard network rate message. You can also enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at 5 p.m. on Sunday the 13th of May will not be counted, but may still be charged. Good luck.
Yes, good luck with that. Now, he was one-sixth of the most famous group of friends in the world, but the other day, Matt LeBlanc joined us in the studio to talk fame, family and the latest episode in his life.
You think if you died, the other friends would come to your funeral?
Yeah, I think they'd come.
Even Jennifer?
Yeah, even Jennifer.
God, can you imagine the press, all of you together again? Well, not you.
Right, because I'd be dead.
Sure, but still.
Still, I'd be dead.
Matt LeBlanc is with us now. How was that sold to you?
That scene?
No, the whole idea of episodes, that you are going to be this self-obsessed guy with a massive ego.
Yeah, you know, originally it was Jeffrey Clarick and David Crane called me up out of the blue, kind of. I mean, I kept in touch with them over the years. They're great guys. They're like my two uncles, you know. I've known them forever. And said, hey, what are you doing? I said, nothing, really. Kind of hanging around. They said, we got an idea. Let's get together for lunch. So I got together, and they pitched me pretty much the whole first season, which, I mean, like beat by beat by beat, all the first seven episodes, and they hadn't put a pen to paper yet, and it was just what you see.
Because it is, I mean, you are playing yourself, but I mean, I hope a very exaggerated version. I mean, nobody by any stretch would kind of think, oh, is that what he's like in real life? It sort of takes the mick of celebrity almost, doesn't it? And the sort of preconceptions that people
have. Yeah, it's sort of, you know, that was my one reservation. I was thinking, well, what do you mean I'd be playing myself? I'm not really comfortable with that. I'm a little more private than that. And they said, well, you know, we're not making a documentary, so it'd be, basically, it's the public's perception of a celebrity, and we just use my name, kind of, be. And it's, like, rough parallels, like, we were both on Friends, and we both looked the same. Aside from that, it's not very accurate.
That's well, you say that they had to persuade you to do it, and are you doing anything, and not very much, because you'd had the huge success of Friends, then you had two seasons of Joey, which we loved, but, you know, that didn't necessarily hit quite so big. And then after that, I think you really decided, I'm going to take a break from all of this.
Yeah, you know, it started by, I had a conversation with my agent, I said, you know, I'm just kind of burned out, you know, I'd gotten divorced and I just wanted some time off. And I said, let me take a year and just not do anything, so don't call me for a year. So he called me a year later and I said, let me take another year. And and then he called me another year later and I said, surprised you still remember me, I'm gonna need another year. And it turned into 5 years of just kind of being a dad and goofing around. And
was this on the ranch?
Yeah, out at the ranch, and I went through a mohawk phase and all kinds of crazy. There's no photos of any of this. But
just you on the farm.
Yeah, cutting my own hair. It was pretty strange.
I guess the good thing about being able to do that and being in that position is that then you can absolutely pick and choose what you want to do. So when you do eventually come back, it's absolutely the right thing.
Yeah, I mean, there were some things that had come across my desk, you know, over that 5 years, and good projects and stuff that's, you know, still in the air, and I wasn't ready to go back to work, and it wasn't something that was, you know, I kind of had some trust issues with writing, and, you know, when I found out it was going to be, when it's David Crane, mm-hmm. You know, I had such a good experience on Friends with him as a writer that, you know, of course I went and listened to what he had to say, and I just think they're so gifted, and I can't say enough good things about the writing on episodes. It's just the economy of their writing. I mean, they have the ability to drive story in a funny way that develops character, and it's so complex. There's like no fat on the bone whatsoever. It's just really, really clean, good writing.
What's interesting about it is that it's obviously it's American writing, but it's got a real British feel about it, actually.
It does, and I don't know if that's a case because you have Steve Mangan and Tamsin Gregg in there with their sort of delivery of all their lines. It's very under, and they really go for the reality of the situation, whereas, you know, my people know me most for, like, Friends was a multi-camera live audience, so that has its... That type of performance, when it's a live audience, sort of tends itself to a big arch version of reality. And with this, it's a single camera, and it's much more about each particular moment, you know, and more like a film.
Well, it ended on a real cliffhanger because you did actually end up in a very brief relationship with Beverly.
Yeah.
Nice way of saying one night stand. There.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
that, it was that brief.
Very PC. Very nice.
We've got a clip. Here you go.
You smell like cinnamon.
Oh, it's Joey.
What?
When Friends was really hot, they got me to do this cologne called Joey.
No.
Yeah. I even got to pick out the scent myself. Turns out I don't have the most sophisticated nose. Plus, the day we did it, I was really hungry.
Which is why you now smell like a cinnamon bun.
Hey.
So, as you say, it's clear no audience there and the difference that that makes. I was actually in the audience of Friends in LA, and I am in an episode, or at least my laugh is in an episode.
I thought that was you.
Yeah? That was me. And it's your line. It's when Joey is frightened of some books scare him and he has to keep them in the freezer and he puts his books in the freezer.
Right.
And I think it's Rachel says, have you tried reading Little Women? And you say, Little Women, how little are they?
Right.
And it made me laugh so much. And I laughed faster than anyone else in the audience. I burst out laughing. You can hear me laugh. And I thought, if they don't retake this, I'm in the show. And they didn't. I am in the show.
Right on.
Forever on tape.
You were all taken out, weren't you? Before Friends started, they took you out and said, you're going to have life together. It will never be the same again.
Yeah, that was Jimmy Burrows. Jimmy Burrows is... Gosh, he must be probably one of the most successful television directors in the business. He directed like every episode of Taxi, every episode of Cheers, almost all of the Frasers. I mean, he's really a legend in the business. And when he talks and gives you a piece of advice, you say, okay, so you must have the crystal ball and you know what you're talking about. But he took the cast to Las Vegas for the weekend. And we had dinner. This is just after we shot the pilot. The show hadn't aired yet, and the show was, I think, it had been picked up already, but we hadn't gone back into production. And he said, we sat at Caesar's Palace in the main dining room at the table right... I mean, there couldn't be a more central table in the room. And there's this big round table, and we sat there, and he said, okay, look around. This is the last time the six of you would be able to go out to dinner together, and it won't be weird. And, you know, you think, well, what are you talking about? Come on, that's not... What is that supposed to mean? And he was right. It's weird.
That's incredible. Yeah.
I don't think anybody could imagine the scale of what was about to happen, what was around the corner.
Yeah, that was a bizarre ride. I mean, it was fantastic, and I feel really fortunate to have been a part of it. And I learned a lot. It was like a 10-year education. You know, I learned from all the actors. I learned from the writing. I learned from the experience as a whole, a production, like how to manage success. And it was... It was great. It was probably the best 10 years of my life.
There's always talk of getting everyone back together again, and certainly, and that's what obviously people who love a series want it to happen. But where are you with that? Would you ever get back together again and do maybe a movie or something?
You know, it's funny you should mention that, because here they are!
No, don't! I'd cry!
Come on in! No, you know... That seems to be this a big thing in the rumor mill these days, but it won't happen because that show was about a period, a finite period of time in everyone's life where school is over and life hasn't quite started yet, and you're not living at home, and you're kind of your friends or your family, and at that point when you're sort of deciding which direction your life is going to go, and to go past that, it's almost like the book is better than the movie. You know, to try and show what those characters are doing now. You know, they all look like this. They're old and grey. Nobody wants to see that.
when did it start, by the way?
It started probably, I think, the second season of Friends. I've been just a little, started with just a little on the side.
A little bit of colour, doing a bit of
colour. A little more, and when they started getting all the way up to the top.
Yeah, look what happens.
Yeah, exactly. I'm catching up to you.
What happens. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's lovely to see you. Thank you very much indeed.
Great to be here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was good, wasn't it?
We found the clip. So the one that we were talking about in there. So this is when I went to Los Angeles to watch, because we were such massive fans of Friends.
Yeah.
To watch an episode of it being made, which was an experience in itself. So you listen to when he says, "These little women, how little are they?" The first laugh is mine.
I will read The Shining, and you will read Little Women.
All right, you got it.
All right.
Okay.
Okay.
And now, Rach, these little women.
Yeah.
How little do they? I mean, are they, like, scary little?
It's only brief. You may have missed it. Once more, short version.
How little do they? I mean, are they, like, scary little?
You can so hear it.
I was so thrilled.
That is, you've got a recognisable laugh as well.
I was so thrilled.
Thank you.
Right, episode is on tomorrow night at 10 p.m. on BBC Two, and still to come is the web closing in on the Mitchells. Brian Dowling has all your soap gossip straight after the break. Don't go away.
Welcome back. Still to come, we'll be putting those EastEnders rumours to Denise Van Outen, yes. Mm.
First, though, we've got some more soap gossip. Brian Dowling's here.
What do you mean, rumours with Denise and EastEnders?
Well, there's rumours that she might be in EastEnders. I think she might be about to dispel those rumours.
Let's hope she is going in.
No, I don't think she is.
I don't think she is.
We bigged it up, well, but she's not.
She's not.
We did sort of big it up.
She can just go home now. It's pointless even happening to you. So, hasn't Corrie been amazing this week? It's still a bit weird, though, watching it at 9 o'clock, because I'm used to watching it at 7:30. It's weird. After all the drama last night with Terry and Tina, Tommy is finally going to see his dad, Terry, for what he is. But he gives him one last test to see if he'll choose money over family. Let's have a sneak peek.
Another time, another place, we'd have made a good team.
Another planet.
Give me the money, son.
I'm no son of yours.
I'm sorry you feel that way, but that is my money, fair and square.
That loan shark killed Tina's dad. You don't take no prisoners.
It's me he's after. You and your bird are small fry.
That's bull and you know it.
I know that you've got my money and I should be on the M6.
Dad, he'll kill us.
Always building up your part. If Rick wants the big bucks, you think he's gonna come after a minimum wage grease monkey? Hand over the money!
It's decision time, Dad. Either it's a relationship with me or 9 grand in cash.
Bam, bam, bam.
He should be on the M6. Let him on the M6. He's an amazing character, Terry, at being evil.
Yeah.
And you almost want him to win, but then you don't. And don't forget, he sold Tommy for 10 grand.
I know.
When he was a baby.
Exactly. He's going to take the money.
So you almost want
run.
Him to get his comeuppance. But we'll have to watch to find out. Now, on Tuesday, we actually showed the tragic death of Paul's wife, Leslie, when she was electrocuted. An amazing storyline. And things are set to get tougher for Eileen as she confesses to Paul that she actually left Leslie alone when she had the accident. Mm. And then everyone on the cobble starts to gossip surrounding the circumstances of actually how she died.
Oh,
so a lot of drama for Eileen in store. Now, there's a lot of rumours yesterday stating Michelle Collins was actually taking time out from Coronation Street, and she has denied those rumours, saying she's not leaving or taking time out. So good news there.
I think she's really found her feet.
She has, because there's a lot of criticism over the accent and stuff. I didn't get that. I think she's amazing at it.
She's really found her feet.
I think she's a really good character. That,
people don't like change at the beginning. Always the same.
You're right.
And then they forget about it.
You're right.
I often am.
She's always right.
Should we go to Enders?
Well, actually, before that,
Sue
Johnson's actually joining Weatherfield as Stella's mom, Gloria. And we have an exclusive. Obviously, that's been mocked up. Sue Johnson does not look like that. Red nail varnish is just not her colour. So, yeah,
that's what it would look like.
That's what she might look like.
Yeah.
So that's going to be good when she joins, because she's an amazing actress. Now, Let's go to EastEnders.
Let's do it.
Now, with Bianca in prison yet again, Carol is threatening to leave Walford and take the children with her. Derek's not happy and he's trying to make her stay. Let's check it out.
Oh, right. I was just trying to get rid of you. Well, it sounds a little bit drastic.
I've only just found him and now you want to take him away?
Well, it's only for a few months.
How many months? When are you guys coming back?
I don't know, all right? It's not forever, but Morgan needs to be able to see his mum.
And what about his dad?
Look, I'm on my way out. Why don't you come over tomorrow and we'll talk about it properly?
No, listen, Caroline.
No, tomorrow, all right? Come and see Morgan tomorrow.
I cannot believe.
You know, during the whole dramatic scene.
We're wrecking the whole thing now.
Yes.
And throughout the whole of that clip, Holly was going, I quite like that wallpaper.
It's a leopard print wallpaper, but it's not like an obvious one. It's quite subtle.
I'm going to move on. Of course, that was Derek manipulating Cara by obviously telling Ray that she's going to leave and, of course, take the children with her. Now, breaking news, the actor, I hope I pronounce his name properly, Matt Lipinskas, who plays Anthony Moon, is actually leaving the show.
I saw this
he's
in the paper
today. He's just
announced
he's leaving EastEnders. So lots of sad ladies, I'm sure, and probably some men as well, because he's quite handsome.
He is a handsome boy.
Yeah. Tonight is a big night for Derek as his daughter Alice rocks up on the square, and it's going to be a long and difficult relationship as Derek has to work hard to win her over. Plus, there's rumours his son Joey is also joining the show, and if they're anything like their father, God only knows what they are capable of. Yes. Now, we all know that Lauren has a severe drink problem. On Tuesday, we've seen her go off the rails again and, of course, get drunk once again. Tonight, her mum, Tanya, fails to talk around and get her to admit her problems. So EastEnders are saying it's going to be a difficult road for her in the future.
Okay.
Now, over to the Mitchell household. Now, Phil gets a phone call from DCI Marsden, who I kind of laugh at her because she's kind of a serious character, saying that Ben won't face any more action for his recent attempt to break the course of justice and, of course, put his dad in jail. But I want to see Ben get his comeuppance for what he did to Heather.
I
do wonder how this storyline will play out and what will happen. Who'll get the blame?
I hope they don't forget it.
Yes, exactly.
Don't breeze over it.
He killed her. It's fine. We love him. Let's have a drink.
Okay.
And, of course, Mandy's departure has started to emerge as she will receive some devastating news the week of her wedding to Ian Beale. So will Ian
You
be
mean
left?
Their wedding isn't going to go smoothly?
No.
Poor Ian. He's so unlucky in love. I kind of feel sorry for him, but he is. He's just not a nice character.
I don't feel sorry for him. He gets lots of women coming in through his life.
How?
Nearly everybody.
How is that possible?
Virtually everyone.
I don't know what you're suggesting.
Of course, Emmerdale. Now, you actually had Steve, who plays Zach, on the show yesterday.
Yep.
He's lied about having cancer. Of course, it's his mind that's falling apart. He's gone missing, and the full extent of his problem is about to dawn on his family. Okay. Let's take a look.
All right. Yeah, not bad, you. Listen, Faber. My dad's on a bender. We could do with finding him. He's gone in his van. Yeah, the same red van. Spread the word, would you? No. I'll call them. You call the people I don't know. And if there's any sign, you tell no one, you just call me, okay?
Okay.
In any emergency, Kane is always really cool. He never kind of shows
any
emotion.
He was late to that particular party because, of course, Zach had whacked him one and hurt him.
Tried to kill him.
It took him a while before he got involved in the search and took it seriously.
Yeah.
I mean, it's actually really very sad.
A very touching storyline. And Emmerdale have an extra episode on Sunday night here on ITV1 at 7:30, which actually sees Zach being sectioned. Meaning dark times ahead for the Dingles, yeah. And it's quite a moving storyline. And Steve plays it so brilliantly.
They are doing really well, actually.
Really well.
Very realistic.
Meanwhile, tonight, Jimmy is still annoyed at Nicola for losing his son, Elliot. And she thinks that she's useless when it comes to his son and that she won't really love him.
Okay.
Quite a good character. I quite like their relationship as well.
Yeah.
Now, Hollyoaks.
Yes.
It's a bit of romance in Hollyoaks as Doug has finally confessed his feelings for Stee. Right. At last, we all seen it coming, but it means that Stee has a decision to make.
I've left Amy all on her own downstairs.
Right.
Cindy doesn't know anything, so.
Right.
Look, I've been going over this in my head. You know, we should really focus on getting Tony's meal done.
Yeah, but we can't leave things like this.
I know. I have actually got a beat somewhere. Just give me 1 minute, please.
Daddy? Switch your phone off silent. Adam's in the deli.
I won't be long.
They look similar.
It's hard to tell them apart, and they are wearing a uniform.
Yes.
Yes, I just looked at that and said, they're wearing the same clothes. But it's the uniform, of course.
And I was horrified when I seen that lady from Hollyoaks showing her bum in a magazine this week at the Soap Awards.
Yes, I think she was horrified as well.
Yeah, it was. I watched the picture going, ooh, I can't look at her in the same way.
Oh, no, poor girl. I feel very sorry.
Funny to watch, but obviously, yeah.
Yes, from the outside.
From the outside.
Not if you're the person.
Or her mother.
Yeah,
well, no, quite right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Brian.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Wonderful. Right, still to come, Denise Van Outen on her baby diaries. And, of course, we won't be asking about those EastEnders rumours because we've just told you that they're not
true. Phil has just said they're not true. Thank you for that.
We'll ask her anyway.
Yeah.
See what she says
after the break.
On tomorrow's show, get set for Britain's Got Talent. Stephen Mahern prepares for Saturday night's final.
We've got What the Butler Saw with comedian Omar Jalili.
And What the Valley Did Next, Downton Abbey's Mr Bates drops in.
Plus, ITV's landmark documentary series, which has followed people since they were seven, is back. See what life's thrown up tomorrow at 10:30. Welcome back. Still to come, Denise Van Outen. First, Samantha's with us in the hub now. What you got?
Well, you're going to be shocked. We've had a huge reaction to Liz Jones' debate with Petri Oskin.
Yeah.
So, people against her, what a surprise. Lee Evans, is Liz Jones for real? I can't believe what I'm hearing. As a father-to-be, I'm angered at what she's said. Debbie Turner says, does that woman live in the same era? What a load of rubbish. Women with kids are just as good at their jobs. And Emma Carr says, when you have maternity leave, it's for bonding and spending quality time and recovering from birth, not for working. But there are some people out there who agree with Liz Jones' attitude that taking maternity leave is just an excuse for a holiday, and basically having babies is just an excuse for a holiday. Richard Folger, I agree with Liz Jones. Women in spare cash jobs, he says, do exactly that. Easy holiday, don't really need full pay, don't care. I don't think the fact that that's a man saying that is going to win him over to anyone either. But Sarah Parry also agrees with Liz. She says if you choose to be a mum, that's a choice. So you're choosing that over a job. And Asia Gordon, I agree with Liz 100%. I think feminism has made many of us deluded about how much we should and can take on. But you can't tell someone you have to choose one or the other and you can't have both. And I'm sure there are plenty of mothers out there who would love not to work and can't afford not to.
And as an employer, she admitted that she had discriminated against younger women who might take time off to go and have babies.
Which is illegal.
She would employ someone who was in their 50s, as you say, which is illegal.
Yeah. I find it shocking.
Anything else?
Well, we're also talking about the £900 million that we waste every year, apparently, buying gadgets that we don't use.
Yeah.
So we've had reams and reams of the tat.
It's
looking that way.
Well, it's all food-related tat that people have that they don't use. Karina, I've got a popcorn maker, smoothie maker, steamer. Leanne, a smoothie maker, a juicer, ice cream maker, soda stream. I always wanted one of those. She says it's her husband that buys all of those. Elaine says, I have a panini press. I don't know what I was thinking. I never have plans to open a sandwich shop.
A panini press?
Why else?
I'm sure that's spelled properly.
I don't know what do you mean? This is one for you. Now, Kara Simpson says, I don't think Philip would agree with this, but see what you think. I think she says, I disagree about the tablet computer being any good. I hate mine, so it doubles up as a tray to bring a couple of drinks in from the kitchen to the dining room.
Don't
you love this?
I even
cut some bread on it the other day. But look at this.
She cut bread on it.
Jalapenos?
Not even I would do that. That's
unbelievable. Actually, I'm feeling a bit faint.
I know.
That's an expensive tray.
Let's not talk about that anymore.
Wow. Thank you very much.
Samantha, thank you. Right, it's over to Andrew McLean in the Loose Women's studio to find out what they've got in store today. You all right?
Yeah, I'm all right.
Coming up today, we are joined by Blue Star Duncan James and Time Team's top man, Tony Robinson. We'll be looking back at the life of hair care pioneer Vidal Sassoon. And as it's been revealed that Rihanna has taken to working out in the wee small hours, we'll be asking if being awake in the middle of the night can ever be a good thing. All that and more at 12:30.
Absolutely. We'll see you later. One big question we have to ask today, and this is something that apparently no one can get the truth of. So the only way we can maybe get the truth is to ask outwardly. Where's your tattoo?
Oh, you're joking. How do you know about that?
We know everything.
Can you tell us where it is?
It's on my bum.
Is it on your bottom?
Is it? Is it? Because apparently a whole load of people go away on holiday with no intention whatsoever to have tattoos. It's in the paper today. And then come back with one. And you are one of those
people. This didn't even feature in the news review. How did this come up?
Well, you know, hashtag Brett's bottom. Right, it's your last chance today to win big in our competition.
I've got a seriously tempting treat to spice up your bank balance. £20,000 in tax-free cash could soon be making a big difference to your cash flow.
Get set for some serious spending this summer with £5,000 to spend in-store at M&S. For your chance to cash in on everything, just answer this question correctly.
Latte and espresso are both types of what? A. Mushroom, B. Coffee, C. Bread. Call 09012 933333. Calls cost no more than £1.03 from BT Landlines. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Text your answer A, B or C to 83336. Text costs £1 plus one standard network rate message. You can also enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at 5 p.m. on Sunday the 13th of May will not be counted, but may still be charged. Good luck.
Yeah, the very best of luck from lads. My favourite to presenter, actress Denise Van Outen has had many transformations over her showbiz career.
But it was while searching for a West End star that this one-time party girl made the biggest transformation of all, finding love, marriage, motherhood and her happy ending.
The look of love is in your eyes. The look your heart can't disguise. I love you so.
We've made our own little story up there, haven't we?
At home watching, I know he'll be laughing. It's proper Mills and Boone.
Well, what's lovely is you said actually that you wish that one day Betsy, your little girl, will find a man to love her and treat her like Lee treats
her.
That's so nice.
I do. I hope that for her. Yeah, because he's lovely to me. He's a brilliant father, brilliant husband. Mm. Couldn't ask for more.
Mm. Well, you're here today to talk about this. This is your second book.
Yes.
Second parenting book. And the first one was Bumpalicious. That was all about pregnancy. This one, however, focuses on life after birth.
Yeah.
Were you watching our debate earlier on?
I watched it.
Yeah.
Liz Jones, she's a one, isn't she?
What did you make of it?
Well, obviously, I'm supportive of women that work. The thing that I find is that, like you said, why is it that as soon as you become a mother, you're under fire from people? Mm. I just don't really understand it. I just think you do what's right for you and what you're prepared to do and what suits you. Mm. I went back to work quite early on, but I was at home all day because I was in Legally Blonde, so I was doing the show in the evening, so I had plenty of time with Betsy. But I see no wrong in it. But
so
also,
did you
if you
have
want to
Betsy
take time off,
to have time off work, or
do you know what?
You know,
anyone will tell you it's the hardest job in the world
the
being a mother,
job in the world.
And it came as a massive shock to me, which is one of the reasons why I wanted to do the book. Mm. Because you go through pregnancy and you read all these different books about, you know, you get advice from different people about having a smooth and healthy pregnancy. But then, as soon as your child arrives, there's no manual, there's nothing, and I felt sometimes a little bit sort of isolated and a little bit alone because didn't have anybody to turn to, like doing night feeds and things like that. So I turned to my Twitter followers and then got the idea that I could do a book. Really, it's sort of a warm hug for women.
Well, it's a lovely idea because I can remember when Molly was young, our eldest, and she was one of those babies that just would not sleep. She would not sleep, woke up every hour, arched her back, you couldn't get her back to sleep again. Steph would get up, I would get up, backwards and forwards, and you'd sit there at 4 o'clock in the morning, think, I must be the only person in the world that's awake.
You do, you feel so alone.
Well, we didn't have Twitter at that time.
No,
that
I know.
It's quite interesting. I used to tweet when I was doing my night feeds, and I used to, and I'd be looking through, and there'd be so many people on the same sort of. You'd meet the same people 3 hours later when they were doing their next feed.
I know.
It's fascinating. But how honest have you been in here?
Because I've been very honest.
Have you?
Yeah, about the highs and lows. Because, you know, I've had friends that maybe they found it really easy, but it did come as a massive shock to me. And first of all, you know, I've had Betsy, I had her quite late. So I'd been sort of an independent single woman for a very long time. So it was a real debate for me about whether I should go back to work or just be at home. But it felt right at the time. And the actual job that I was offered allowed allowed me to do both. Mm. Yeah. It just meant that I was exhausted.
Yes.
But I do think you can have it all, but in moderation. You have to just find balance. Yeah. You know, with everything, with your relationships, with your family, everything.
You've been very honest, because you said that on your sort of 37th birthday, you had a bit of a mummy meltdown.
Yeah, I had a big mummy meltdown. And I couldn't really explain it at the time, but looking back, I was obviously still very hormonal. But it was just silly things, and it just now it seems stupid, because it was just things that I couldn't make the bed. Betsy wouldn't stop crying, couldn't answer the phone to anybody. I mean, just things that, you know, when you're at home, and I was so stressed, and my friends had said, let's go out together, and it'd be really nice to get the girls together. And I just felt like I couldn't go, because I felt like everything was out of control.
It's too much.
So, yeah, it's just emotion, and I just kind of wanted to share that, because I think sometimes women do go through that and they feel guilty for admitting it and actually saying that they found it hard. You know, and I've got some friends that have, like, their children, and they say, oh, it's, you know, I found it so easy and it's brilliant, and they never tell you about the hard times, and then they'll tell you, like, 3 years later and say, I really struggled.
Well, I think guilt is a massive thing for any mother, because you sort of feel guilty about everything, guilty about not being there, guilty about smothering them too much.
Yeah.
And also, you sort of think that when you become a mother, it's like, you know, you've been blessed with this baby, and so therefore you should naturally just be the most wonderful super mum. And it's not always like that, is it?
No, you have your very difficult times. But yeah, no, you know, I've got a friend of mine who's about to have a baby, and we worked together, and she said to me, you know, I'll be back in a couple of months. And I said, honestly, take as long as you want to take, because I'll still be here and we can pick up where we left off. Mm. You know, if she wants to take a year, I think it's up to the individual, and you know what you're prepared to do, what you can manage.
Mm. What about when you get back as a couple, you try and get some time together? You do date nights and things, don't you?
We try to. I mean, it's still a juggling act, you know, because we both work, and it is difficult. We actually did that classic thing where we went, Lee and I went away to a hotel for a night, and we stayed overnight, and it was all lovely. And the next morning, we were supposed to go and meet friends for lunch. And we were like, should we just pop home and check on Betsy? Completely defeated the object of being away and having time together.
Dan and I did the same thing. We went to Paris. We were supposed to be there for the weekend, and we went for a night.
But you do, don't you? You can't help yourself. But everybody knows it is the hardest job in the world, and I never understood it until I became a mum.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, it's difficult. So hopefully people will like this book. And
we should give this book to Liz Jones, shouldn't we?
I think we should. Or she should just come and stay with me for, you know, a couple of weeks and help me out.
Well, what about thinking about another one then?
We'd like to, but we go in waves, and it's just that thing of, you know, there's never a right time and never a wrong time. You just never know, do you? And Betsy's only just gone into nursery, so we said we'd let her get settled first of all, and then we'd sort of decide and
see what happens. And
we've
got to ask you, although I think we've dispelled these rumours ourselves already today, the EastEnders rumours.
Oh, do you know what? This came out of, I was at the Soap Awards when I saw you, Philip, and I was doing the red carpet, and a journalist said to me, do you watch soaps? And I said, well, I watch EastEnders. And she said, if there was any soap you could be in, which one would it be? And I said, well, the obvious choice would be EastEnders, because it's the one that I watch. And then from that, it became this, you know, so...
You'd be good, though.
You know, I'd never rule it out. I'd love to do it.
Yeah.
Pull a few pints.
Well, this is what you'd look like if you were behind the bar. There you go. We were hoping you were going to say that. Look at that. Oh. See, it works.
See, it does. Yeah, you never know if they'd have me. Probably not now.
Well, you'll be busy because you're developing your one-woman show, aren't
you? Yes, yeah. A fantastic writer called Terry Ronald has been developing it with me, and I'm very excited about it. And it's something that, actually, when I became a mum, it allowed me to do, because I wanted to take a little bit of time out, spend time with Betsy. And it kind of worked well, because I'd be at home writing.
So it's early days, it's not...
Yeah, it's in development, but we're going to start...
Come and tell us about it.
I will,
When it gets
like
up.
Like a modern Shirley Valentine, you say, something like that.
Yeah.
That's like a great idea.
Thank you very much indeed.
Here we go, that's the book we're talking about, Adventures in Parenthood.
It's out today.
Right, on tomorrow's show, Eamon and Ruth are looking ahead to this weekend's Britain's Got Talent.
Plus, Mr. Bates has escaped prison.
Oh?
Yes, Downton Abbey, Brendan Cole is here.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Well, Duncan James and Tony Robinson stop by for lunch with the Loose Women next this afternoon. We're turning a gloomy home into something far more stylish with 60 Minute Makeover at 2, and turning trinkets into treasure. David Dickinson has the real deal today at 3.